Hi, my name is Robert Haas. I work at EnterpriseDB, where my current job title is VP Chief Architect Database Servers. And my talk is about incremental backup, which is a new feature that I developed for PostgreSQL 17. I'm hoping that this feature will be of particular interest to people who have large databases and are looking for some new backup and restore options. So in fact, the problem of really large databases and the difficulty of doing backup and restore of really large databases was actually the main motivation for trying to create this feature. I have heard of cases where people had a database that was so large that it actually took more than one day to perform a full backup of the system, which then means that you can't actually have a daily backup because it just becomes not technically possible. So the idea of this feature is that instead of copying the entire database when we make a backup, let's try to copy only the portions of the database that have actually changed. And by doing that, we hope to reduce the size of the backup, possibly quite drastically, but more importantly, we hope to reduce the time it takes to complete the backup because the data that isn't copied doesn't need to be transmitted over the wire to wherever the backup is going to be stored. Now, this is not a new idea. Obviously, there are non-PostgreSQL implementations of this type of feature. And even in the PostgreSQL space, there are various out-of-core tools and proprietary forks of PostgreSQL that have offered this type of functionality in the past. But we have not had anything in PostgreSQL itself that does this. So that was really my goal here. Before I go on, just a brief disclaimer. This is a new feature. So it might have bugs. In fact, even old features have bugs because pretty much all code has bugs. And the bugs in this feature, if there are any, which is likely, are particularly scary because they are probably data corrupting bugs. So do please try out this feature and let me know how it goes for you. But please also be careful because, it is brand new and things could definitely go wrong. Let's start by looking at what you need to do if you want to take an incremental backup. There is one piece of configuration that you need to do in order to use this feature, and that is that you need to set the new parameter summarize wall to on. The default is off, and this parameter only supports this particular feature. You don't need to enable summarize wall for any purpose other than incremental backup, but if you do want to use this feature, you need to turn it on. And then you need to either reload the configuration, or if you prefer, you can restart the whole database server. Now, once you've done that, you can go ahead and take a full backup, which works just the same way that it normally would. Here in this example, I've used the -c fast option, which you would not necessarily want to do on a production server, but I've done it here because this is just for testing purposes. And I've set the name of the directory that will be created by this command to Sunday. Once we've got that backup done, we can go ahead and take an incremental backup based on Sunday's backup. And you see an example of that here in the third bullet point on the slide, where I specify the new --- incremental option to PG-based backup. And as an argument to that option, I provide the path name to the backup manifest from the previous backup on which the new incremental backup will be based. So in this case, Monday's backup is going to be an incremental based on Sunday. So I provide Sunday's backup manifest as an argument to --- incremental. If we then roll forward another day to Tuesday, we now have some options because we now have two previous backups. So Tuesday's incremental backup could be taken relative either to Sunday's full backup or to Monday's incremental backup. We can decide which one we want to do. Now, in this example here and throughout the talk, I'm going to be showing you examples that are assuming that we are using PG-based backup directly. But that is most likely not what you actually want to do because this tool only provides the raw functionality of taking a backup and, as we'll see later, also being able to sort of get back to a full backup from the incremental backups that you may have. It doesn't provide all of the other infrastructure that you're going to want to have around the backup and restore process. For example, there is no backup catalog. There is no backup retention here. There is no tracking of dependencies between backups or where any of your backups are stored. And this can all be quite tricky. So I strongly recommend that you don't try to write your own backup tool, but instead you use a high-quality backup tool that supports whatever it is that you want to do with PG-based backup, whether it's this feature or whatever. I'm not completely familiar with all of the backup tools that exist in the PostgreSQL ecosystem. I do know that Barman, which is maintained by some of my colleagues here at EnterpriseDB, has added support for this functionality. So that's one option if you want to use this feature. If the backup tool that you're using doesn't support this feature, then you could rethink using this feature, or you could rethink your choice of backup tool, or maybe you want to encourage the maintainers of that backup tool to add support for this feature. But do be careful about rolling it completely on your own, even though all of the examples that I'm going to be showing you in these slides work in exactly that way. Let's talk a little bit about how this works. I just showed you how we can take an incremental backup, but what is really happening there? What is the technical problem that needs to be solved in order for us to successfully take an incremental backup? Well, the core issue is figuring out which data has changed. And we have a few requirements here. The first one, and the most crucial one, is that we need to be accurate. We need to be accurate in both directions, but one of them is especially important. So the really, really important direction is that if we think some data has not changed when it actually did, then the result of that would be that we would not include it in our backup, and so that data would be lost. If we later did a restore from that backup, it wouldn't contain the data that was changed, and there would be no other copy of that data, and that data would simply be lost, which would be very likely to result in a corrupted database. The other direction is slightly less critical, but still pretty important. If we think that some data has changed when it really didn't, that's not going to break anything. It's not going to corrupt our database, but it will make our backups larger. So if that happened occasionally, I guess that would be all right. But if it happens too often, it defeats the whole purpose of creating this feature. So our first requirement here is accuracy. Accuracy is really important. But our second requirement is almost as important, which is that we want this to be efficient. It is going to be really, really important that we're able to determine what data has changed and what data has not changed without too much effort. So, you know, we can't afford at the time that you're trying to take an incremental backup to go grovel for a possibly really large amount of data. We can't afford to look through the contents of the entire database to decide what needs to be backed up and what doesn't, or we can't afford to go look through the entire write-ahead log to figure out what needs to be backed up and what does not, because it will just require too much time and access to too much data on disk. A third requirement that I had here is that this system should be something that is easy to implement. It should reuse as much existing code and infrastructure as possible, partly for my benefit, because I wanted to finish the feature in a reasonable amount of time, but even more for the benefit of users, because the more new code and infrastructure has to be introduced in order to support this feature, the more bugs we're likely to have. By relying as much as possible on existing things that are hopefully already well-tested and well-debugged, we reduce the risk for everyone who's using this feature. And my fourth requirement, a little bit more debatably, is I wanted something that was not going to rely on operating system features. I wanted something that was going to give everybody the same experience, regardless of your choice of operating system, your choice of file system, your choice of hardware, any of those kinds of things. I didn't want to depend on any anything special there. I wanted to assume a generic PostgreSQL environment and create a feature that was going to work the same way for all PostgreSQL users. Now, as I thought about these requirements, I realized that the write-ahead log satisfied almost all of them. PostgreSQL's write-ahead log already contains all of the information about which blocks have been modified. And the write-ahead log has a very long track record. It's used for crash recovery. It's used for physical replication. It's used for logical replication. You can use it for point-in-time recovery. You could do all sorts of cool things with it. And it has existing debugging tools like pgwalldump and pgwallinspect. And it has a very long track record of people finding and fixing problems with it. So it's pretty battle-tested at this point. And it really ticks just about every box that we need to tick in order to be able to have this feature. But it has one very large problem, which is that the write-ahead log is very, very big, which means we really cannot use it directly to power this feature. Between the time that you take one backup and the time that you take a later incremental backup based on that earlier backup, you might generate hundreds of gigabytes of write-ahead log records, or even terabytes of write-ahead log records. And going through all of that data is simply going to take too much time. So that's not really an option. So what I chose to do is add a new wall summarizer process, which will read the write-ahead log as it's generated and produce very, very small wall summary files containing only the information which is absolutely required to drive incremental backup. It turns out that the overwhelming majority of what's present in the write-ahead log isn't actually needed in order to power this feature, because the write-ahead log will tell you exactly how each data block was changed. And it will tell you in exactly what order blocks were changed. And it will make a record of each time the same block was modified, even if that block was modified over and over again. And we don't really care about any of that for our purposes here. The only thing we need to be able to do is answer the question, between one backup and a later backup, was there at least one modification to a particular data block at any time during that window? So by taking advantage of that, we're able to go through the very large volume of data that's present in the write-ahead log and essentially compress that down to the much smaller amount of information that we need to power this feature. So the point is that those wall summary files, which are created by this new wall summarizer process, taken together with the backup manifest, gives us everything that we need in order to identify changed blocks and files. And that's how we're able to take the incremental backup both quickly and also correctly. Now, the next challenge is, how do we go ahead and restore that backup once we have it? Let's revisit the scenario that we looked at earlier, where we've got a full backup on Sunday, an incremental backup on Monday, and then another incremental backup on Tuesday, which we're going to say is based on Monday's backup. If we think about the state of the world at this point, where is our data? Or to put the question differently, if we want to restore the backup from Tuesday, where do we need to go to find the data that we need for that purpose? Well, everything that has changed between Monday and Tuesday is in the Tuesday backup. And everything that changed between Sunday and Monday is in the Monday backup, and everything else is in the Sunday backup. So we're going to need all three backups to restore, but we don't need the entirety of all three backups. We just need to sort of combine pieces of what is in each of these three backup directories in order to get what we need. And so that's the motivation behind the naming of this new tool, PG Combined Backup, which combines the data that you need from each of the input directories into a single output directory. You can see we run it here with all three of our backups in order from the first one taken to the most recent one taken. And then you use the dash O option to provide an output directory, which in this case I called Tuesday Full. And I called it Tuesday Full because the output of PG Combined Backup is actually a synthetic full backup of the PostgreSQL data directory. And that means that all of the steps that you would need to perform with any other PostgreSQL full backup still need to be performed. And in particular, that means that database recovery is required, and we need to replay all of the write-ahead log records that were generated during the backup, in this case, during the Tuesday backup, since that's the one that we're restoring. All of those write-ahead log records need to be replayed. And there are different ways that you can do this, depending on what makes sense in your setup. You can stage those files in the pgwall directory, or you can set primary con info or restore command to either stream those write-ahead log files or recover them from an archive. The details here depend on exactly what you're trying to do and what your environment is. And a good backup tool is going to manage this for you, which is another good reason to use one. But the point I really want to make here is that incremental backup does not let you skip any step that would otherwise be required. It's just an additional step that needs to be performed before you get started with the things that you would normally do as part of a recovery. So just to sum up what I've said in this talk very briefly, if you configure summarize wall equals on, that will run the new wall summarizer process, which will read the write-ahead log and write out small wall summary files. Once you've done that, pgbase backup dash dash incremental can use the data in the backup manifest that you provide in combination with the wall summary files on the server to create an incremental backup. Once you've done that, PG combined backup can reconstruct a synthetic full backup from your incremental backup and the earlier backups on which it depends. And then you'll still need to perform recovery as usual. And finally, a backup catalog, backup retention policies, and all of those kinds of things are out of scope for this feature. It only handles the taking of the backup and the reconstruction of the synthetic full backup. For everything else, you do need to rely on tools external to PostgreSQL. So that's all I've got. Thank you very much for watching my talk, and I will be answering questions in the chat. Thank you.